Prayer this afternoon that you will grant us audience, for we are your children. Come and fill us with your goodness. Come and restore us to the place of glory. Come and revive us. Come and renew your right spirit in us. May you use me this afternoon to bless your people. In Jesus' name I pray with thanksgiving. Amen.
Amen.
Beloved in the Lord, we're grateful unto God for making it possible for us to be here to have fellowship, not with one another, but also with God. Amen.
Amen.
And we thank him for his keeping power, that he has kept watch over us throughout the week. Church, our topic for discussion this afternoon is repentance. Repentance is such a doctrinal topic. Amen.
Amen.
But what we want to talk about is, what is the true meaning of it, and why is the Lord expecting of us when it comes to repentance? And as I was sharing the same message this morning with Trinity, I told them that yes, we are serving a God who desires the best for us. We are serving a God who wants us to be happy. We are serving a God who wants us to prosper. We are serving a God who wants to see us progress in life. But before all this can happen, we have to make sure that our lives are in agreement with the commandments and also the desires of God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And therefore, if we are not on the right course, if we are not doing what is expected of us, then that is why we are discussing this afternoon, the topic repentance. Then let us repent and come to him. And when we come to him, he will direct us, he will lead us, he will guide us into prosperity, so that we will realize that happiness, that dream, and that vision. Church, as I want to explain and a little bit talk about this theme of repentance, I just want to explain that repentance, you can talk about it in three ways. Sometimes we define it to be when one turns away from sin, and that is how that's all most of it we talk about, turning away from sin and turning towards God. Then we say that we've repented. Even when we're young, we walk to people and sometimes we ask them, have you repented of your sins? And we ask that. But change, so my goal into it before one repents. And there are three things I want us to know about repentance. Number one, repentance has got to do with our intellect. Amen.
Amen.
So repentance has got to do with what? Our intellect. And number two, repentance has also got to do with our emotions. And number three, repentance is very practical. So it's got to do with our intellect, it is about our emotions, and number three, it is very practical. So what do I mean by this in connecting it to repentance? There was this young man that was traveling. He was supposed to go to New York. So he bought a ticket and he joined a train. So he was on the train about 30 minutes into the journey. Then he found out that he was on the wrong train. Instead of going to New York, that particular train was going to towards Florida. So he gained knowledge. That's what I'm talking about. Repentance is about the intellect. So in his mind, he gained the knowledge that no, I didn't mean to travel to Florida. I am not supposed to be in this train. I meant to go to New York. So I am on the wrong what? Route. On the wrong train. So he had that knowledge that yes, something is wrong. And that's the same thing about repentance. Where you ask yourself, am I going the way of God? Am I going in the directions of God? Am I doing the things that God is expecting of me to do? Yes, he's also preaching. Because he wants us to repent.
Yeah.
So when you gain that knowledge, that no, I don't think I am walking in the orders of God. I don't think I am walking in the steps of God. Then your intellect begins to paint the ways of God to you. That this is where you are supposed to go. Therefore, you need to make a U-turn. You need a 180 turnover. And you say to yourself that I meant to go with God. And I meant to go by his commandment. And if I look at what I'm doing now, it looks like I am not going in the ways of God. So in your mind, you begin to talk to yourself that I am on the wrong train. What do I mean by emotions? That has got to do with repentance also. You see, when the young man found out that he was on the wrong train, he became angry with himself. And instead, that emotion, was it by mistake? Was it the train conductor? Was it the person who sold the ticket to me? So he was not comfortable. He was not happy. He became so angry. And then, emotions were high. Then he said, I have to do something. And sometimes we have to come to that point where we say to ourselves that this is not how God wants me to live my life. This is not the way God wants me to go. And then you say to yourself, I am not going to accept this, and I am not going this way of the devil. And therefore, I want God to do something. And for God to do something, then I have to turn around. I have to repent and come to him. And the third thing why I meant is practical. So when the guy realized that he was on the wrong train, when he became so angry, he did the practical thing. He got on the train. Amen.
Amen.
To be on the right train. So repentance is practical. You have to do something. You just don't think about it. You just don't fight about it. But you take a step, a practical step. And you change the dynamics of your life and change. So it is not just about taking away from sin. Repentance is about changing your focus in life. Repentance is more about changing your purpose and asking yourself, are my purposes and intentions aligning with that of God? When the answer is no, then you have to change your course, and practically you have to get off the train like this young man, and then you'll be on the right train that can take you to heaven. Amen.
Amen.
And church, this morning as we celebrate this day also, it is a day where we call the World Communion Sunday. Worldwide Communion Sunday. And in the Reformed tradition, we want each and every Christian or each and every Protestant member to have communion today. And church, why are we talking about communion and then also repentance? I believe we are doing this because God wants us to come and commune with him. God wants our lives to be right with him. God wants us to do what is expected of us. God wants us to obey his word. God wants us to be on the right train and on the right path, that highway of righteousness which will take us to heaven. And therefore, as we are talking about repentance, I want us to understand, number two, why the need for repentance. We've seen what repentance is all about. That one, it is about the intellect. Number two, it is about the emotions. And number three, it is through practical. Then we're asking ourselves, how do we move from there? So we take that step of faith. And by taking that step of faith, then we are also telling ourselves that when I turn around, when I change my mind, What is expected of me? And I want to give us three things. Number one, we are supposed to repent, or we are expected to return, in that we have been called by God. Amen. Therefore, we cannot do things our own way. We cannot do things the way of the world. We cannot do things the traditional way, because there is a calling upon our lives. And because of that calling, we have to repent. We have to mend our ways. We have to do what is good. God has called us. And because of that, we need repentance. Amen.
Amen.
Have you heard that voice? Are you going by the direction of that voice? Are you obeying the commandment of that voice? We have a calling upon our being called. And church, you see, when someone calls you in the night, that maybe you are there and someone will shout your name, hey, I'm going down soon. Get up and come to the street. What is the first person I have to do? The first thing I need to do? Who are you? I need to know the voice. Because when I don't know the one calling and I get out, I might be shot, I might be killed, anything can happen to me. So number one, as we are talking about the calling of God upon our lives, we have to know the God who has called us. Amen. We have to know the God who has done what? Called us. Because I believe that this young man on the train heard a voice that, hey, Kwaku, you are on the wrong train. And he decided, wow, then I have to do something. And practically he got up. So God has called us, but we have to know that God. And last week as I was ending, I asked this practical question. And I want to ask this question today. Do you know your God? Hallelujah.
Amen.
When you know him, Jesus said, my sheep knows my voice. Hallelujah. Amen. When you know him, you will know his voice. When you know him, you obey him. When you know him, you will allow him to have his way in your life. So when we are talking about repentance, it is not just turning around, but it is where we want to affirm our calling and then to tell him that, Father, if it is you that has called us, then we want to know you. Open our eyes, open our minds, open our ears so that we can see you, we can encounter you, we can hear you, because we have to make sure that our calling is surely is affirmed. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Know that God has called us. And if you study critically from the Old Testament, God called men and women. He called a man we called Adam. And he was trying to use him to serve as a light to the world. And sin entered into Adam. And therefore God chose another child called Abel, and Cain killed Abel, and God brought another guy called Seth, and God was trying to call people to do something. God was trying to call people to achieve his aim and his purpose. And if you read carefully, if you want to understand the Bible, it is all about this calling of God. And then God called a man by the name Abraham, and God told Abraham, get out of your hometown, get out of your family, and go to the place I will show you. So Abraham paid heed to the call. Hallelujah. There is also a calling upon your life, a calling to lead to sing, a calling to lead to pray, a calling to be an evangelist. There is a calling, and the only thing needed is to pay heed to that voice. Hallelujah.
Amen.
So Abraham paid heed. Why was this calling so important? And that leads me to the second thing I want to address about calling. He said, not only is God calling us, but he's also trying to give us an assignment to fulfill. So the purpose of God calling Israel into existence as a nation was that they will serve as a light, so that the people around him in darkness will come into that light, and then they will serve the God of Israel. Hallelujah. So if you study in theology, there's what we call the centrifugal and the centripetal activity of God in missions, where God called Israel. And Israel was like centripetal. What is centripetal? A bravo for the doctors.
Amen.
Amen. So, the centripetal is where a force that attracts. A force that does what? Attract. So, like magnets. When there are other nails around, you see, there's a force in the magnet that would do what? Who attract. So, when God called Israel, he asked them to serve as a centripetal, as a force. And that force is the force of holiness, the force of righteousness, so that your way of living, your lifestyle, will attract people and they will come to the knowledge of God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
But in the next New Testament, we've been called, and our call is more centrifugal. In other words, instead of we waiting for them, Jesus said, go into all the world. Hallelujah. And that is our calling. And our calling comes when it is silent. We cannot go when our lives are not right. We cannot go when we are living in sin. We cannot go when we are the children of darkness. We can only go when we've been washed and the blood has taken care of our sins. We can only go when we are as white as snow. And that leads us to our first reading. So then the writer said, Lord, wash me and I shall be washed because of your calling upon my life and because of your assignment, so that my life can serve as a light to this lost world.
Amen.
Hallelujah. So in talking about repentance, God wants our happiness, God wants our progress, God wants our peace. Therefore, he is calling us out of the world and set us apart and use us for his glory. Pay heed to this voice. Allow him to change you. Know the God who has called you. And also understand that a child to keep we have and a God to glorify. What is that charge? To keep the faith, to obey the words of God, and to live a life that will glorify him. So we used to sing it, a child to keep, I have a God to glorify. So that is our calling, church, this afternoon. And then listening to talk about the second point, about repentance. So not only are we called, but upon our calling, we are also expected to be committed to our call. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And then we expect them to be what?
Committed.
So number one, in repentance, we are being asked to change our focus, our direction, and our purpose, and to make sure that it aligns with God. And we have to accept and understand that we are called children. And as called children of God, we cannot live like the people of darkness. We cannot live like the people in the world. Our lives must be in conformity with the word of God. And the second thing I want to address is that not only are we called to know the master and to know that we have assignment, but we are called to be committed to the task of God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
To be committed to the church. To be committed to the Bible. You see, commitment means that you commit yourself to something that when you go to some other faith, they believe that when you don't pray, when you don't read and pray, you cannot eat. Especially the Muslims and the Jewish. Before you put food in your mouth, you have to read. The Jewish people, they read the Old Testament, the Torah, especially. Then the Arabs also, and the Muslims, they also read the Quran. So the Christians also, we are supposed to read the New Testament. But we are not committed to that. But the Jewish are committed to it. I remember last week, I was in Washington, D.C. with old man, Mr. Degwe. We went there to buy something. So in the shop in which we were buying, actually was this man. He was a Muslim. The shop belongs to the Muslim, to a Muslim. So this guy was reading aloud. He read about 15 minutes. And some of the things he was reading in the Quran were so beautiful. And after he read, he took a bread and water. Then the guy would say, oh, are you done reading? I said, yes, that's what I'm eating. They are committed to that. Church. The same thing happens to us in our repentance. We have to be committed to the cross. We have to be committed to the way of God. We have to be committed to the Bible. So when you're committed to it, it means that if you don't have your way, you have to go by that way. You can't do it your way. You have to do it by that person's way. So in our calling, there's a commitment we have to make. A commitment to be righteous. A commitment to be holy. Because the Bible says that he who has called us is holy. Therefore, we have to be what? Holy. And this is a commitment. This is what sometimes we call when you bear your own cross. It can be tough, it can be difficult, it can be rough. But it's part of the commitment. It's part of the process of repentance. And when we understand and when we commit to Him, He will give us the strength. He will help us. And the third thing I want to talk about is this. Not only has God called us, not only is there a commitment, but the last thing is that He wants Christ to dwell in us spiritually. Hallelujah. Amen. He wants Christ to do what? Because when you are not repented and you are in the world, Satan dwells in you. Demonic forces dwells in you. And therefore, when you repent and you pay heed to the calling of God and you are committed to the way of God, then Christ must dwell in you. Hallelujah. Amen. Christ must dwell in you. And Paul says something that Christ in you is the hope of what? Glory. So when we allow Christ to dwell in us, He will give us strength in the places of our weakness. He will give us testimonies where there are trials. He will give us a message in the midst of our mess. And He will turn our lives around. That is when the song will be singing, Jehovah turns my life around, becomes so practical and so important and so good. Allow Christ to dwell in you. Allow Christ to live in you. And when Christ dwells in you, He will be like a conductor. He will be like a bus driver. He will drive you on the path of righteousness. You and I shall encounter God. We shall know God. And we shall do what is expected of God. Change, repentance, is where we turn away from that which is evil and begin to go on the way of righteousness. Repentance is where we change our minds, knowing that what we're going was not meant for our good and will deliver help us, and we change our purpose. Remember, there are three things that makes our repentance so sure and concrete. One, it is your intellect. So what is going on in your mind? Hallelujah.
Amen.
Number two, it is more of the emotions. Are you okay with sin? Or you are angry with sin? And number three, remember, it is so practical. And I want to end on this practical note. In fact, if you read in Luke chapter 3, verse number 7. From verse 7. Luke chapter 3, from verse number 7. If you don't mind, I would like us to read. Luke chapter 3. We are reading from verse number 7. And I want to end on a practical aspect of repentance. I'm reading from verse number 7. Luke chapter 3. When the crowds came to John for baptism, he said, "You brood of snakes, who warned you to flee the coming wrath? Prove the way you live that you have repented of your sins and then turned to God. Don't just say to each other, 'We are saved, for we are the descendants of Abraham.' That means nothing. For I tell you, God can create children of Abraham from these very stones. Even now, the axe of God's judgment is poised, ready to sever the roots of the tree. Yes, every tree that does not produce good fruit will be chopped down and thrown into the fire." Then, verse 10, look at the practical aspect of it. When they heard the news, when they heard the calling, and they want to be committed to the ways of God, they started doing the practical test. Then the crowd asked, "What should we do?" Hallelujah. That's why I say repentance is more practical. Where you ask yourself, "What should I do?" You claim to know God. So what should I do? And the answer is obey Him. Follow Him. Allow Him to have His way in your life. Allow Him to be the master over your life. Allow Him to be the Lord over your life. Allow Him to take over the baton, because the battle is not yours. The battle is the Lord's, and as you repent, allow him to have his way. So he said, the people came, and in fact, not only did one group came to see him, but he said, John replied, if you are two shares, hallelujah, repentance is so practical. So we be so selfish and so inward thinking. We only think about ourselves, we only care about ourselves, but as we are repenting, we are also being given an assignment that go home and do this. So they asked John, what should we do? And then John said, as you are going, if you have two shares, don't go and give them to yourself. But if indeed you have repented, then go and share the shares that you have. Hallelujah. You have two shares, give one to the poor. If you are full, share it with those who are what? Hungry. And also I said that the tax collectors came to be baptized. And the tax collectors also asked, what should we do? He replied, collect no more taxes than the government requires. Hallelujah. Then the police and the soldiers also came. He said, what should we do? Ask some soldiers. John replied, don't extort money or make false accusations and be content with your pay. Hallelujah. So the people were asking practical questions, things that they can do to show that they have come and they are bearing the fruit of what? Repentance. Amen.
Amen.
So church, as we want to go home, what is the meaning of repentance? It is all about changing from our own focus, our own purpose, and beginning to focus on what God has for us. Hallelujah.
Amen.
The agenda of God, the kingdom agenda of God. Then we have to pay heed to the one who has called us. And we have to be committed to him. And we have to allow Christ to dwell in us richly. As you go home, remember, repentance is more about your intellect. What is going on in your mind? Change. Allow him to touch your mind. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Remember, it's about the emotions. Be angry with sin. Be angry with what doesn't please God. Be angry when the wicked are prospering. And remember, repentance is more practical. You have to take a step of faith. Accept Christ. Accept that my situation is not good. Take that step of faith and God will come through for you.
Amen.
He will honor his word in your life. The weak shall be strong. The poor shall be rich. Those in darkness shall see the light of God. The sick shall be healed. And the glory of God shall fill us.
Amen.
Go knowing that repentance can make your life better. It will bring God into the equation, and all things shall work for our good. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Shall we bow our heads as we pray? That Father, help me to hear your voice. Help me to hear that voice as you are calling. As you are calling, help me to hear your voice. Mention my name, man. Father, call me out of the confusion. Call me out of the darkness and give me that assignment, that divine assignment to go and shine in this dark world. Help me, Lord. Help me, Lord, to be able to know your voice, to know you, so that, Lord, you will use me to fulfill your divine assignment. And you also on the wrong train. Pray that God will create that awareness in your mind and in your heart. You will come to that knowledge to know that I am on the wrong path. I am doing the wrong thing. What I'm doing is not good. It's not acceptable in sight of God. What I'm doing is not in conformity with the word of God. What I'm doing is in complete opposite to what God is expecting of me. And as you get that knowledge, be angry about it and pray for mercy. So David prayed that God have mercy upon me and God have mercy upon us and call upon him and he will come to your aid. He will come into the equation. He will come and make all things possible. It is practical. If people ask, what should we do? When you are not tithing, then you begin to tithe. When you are not praying, then you begin to pray. When you are not reading the Bible, then you begin to read the Bible. Go and do the practical things. Pray that God give me the strength. Grant me the strength to do the practical things. Grant me the strength to do what is expected of you. Yes, that we need Him every hour, every moment to empower us to go on a path of righteousness. As we repent, remember He's calling us to serve as a light to the world. We are expected to be committed to the ways of God. And we have to allow Christ to dwell in us richly. Ask yourself, is Christ dwelling in me richly? So Christ will tell you, pray that Christ dwell in me, dwell in me. Yes, David prayed that take not your good spirit from me. When Christ dwells in you, that is a good spirit. Pray that Christ come and dwell in me. Christ will be digging in. Because when Christ rules, when Christ reigns, it shall be well. When Christ reigns, the battle is going to be easy. When Christ reigns in our lives, yes, things are going to work out well. Let Him dwell in you richly. He is calling. Be committed to Him. Be committed to His ways. Allow Christ to dwell in you richly. Take that step, practical step. As the people ask, what should we do? As you go home, pray that, Father, what should I do to help this church? What should I do to help your kingdom business? What should I do with my finances? What should I do with my prayer life? What should I do with my calling? God will minister to you. Father, we're grateful to you this afternoon. No. Father, if we are on the wrong train in life, if we are charting the wrong course in life, Father, we pray. May you help us to gain that knowledge and that insight to know that, Father, you want us to repent. That as we turn over, you're going to change over our lives. Holy Spirit of God, we subdue before you. Call us out and use us for your glory. Give us enablement to fulfill our divine assignment, knowing that you want us to go and shine as light in the world. You want us to go and serve as good examples to the people around us, so that through us, they will come to know you. Holy Spirit of God, may you come to dwell in us richly. May you come to fill our hearts. May you come so that we'll walk in you. Christ will be formed in us, and we shall be called the children of righteousness. To the glory and praise of your name, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
With all that you have, and in all humility, can I ask you, in whom do you believe?
By the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and